So, thank you very much, Ambassador Hoff, for these indeed very interesting remarks. I think it's a very good start for this whole day of a conference because it has tackled various aspects of the Syrian conflict, and I'm very sure that we will take it up in the different sessions we're going to have today on the role on Iran, especially on the question of Western intervention. So I'm very sure it's a really good starting for us. And we only have an hour and 20 for this panel here, so I would like to jump right away into the discussion up here. And I'm very glad and honored that we have two other Syrian specialists out here on the podium, which I quickly want to introduce you. The first next to me is Ola Ramadan. She is the founder and managing director of the organization BADEL, which is Alternatives. Her work focuses on the areas of human rights, conflict resolution, and peace building in Syria, as well as sexual and gender-based violence among the refugees in the MENA region. You have been an activist for quite a long time, and Ola was also the winner of the 2014 No Peace Without Justice Prize of Human Rights Awards. Next to her is Jihad Yazici. He's a journalist and founder of and editor of the Syrian Report. For all of you who are interested in economics of Syria, this is really the website where you should go to. This is where we get also our reports about the economic situation. I think it's really worth visiting there. And he's been working in Lebanon mainly, and he has published a very interesting document, I think it's a year ago, which was titled The Syrian War Economy, which gives you very good insight of what is happening on the economy side in Syria. My name is Elias Perabo. I'm one of the co-founders of Adopt a Revolution, and I will try to moderate this panel here a little bit today. And I'm sure a lot of you would like to jump in and have a lot of questions regarding the keynote we just heard, but I just want to be patient. We will get to that. You can be part of this discussion later on. We just want to give the panel here first row to participate. The title of this session, as it is in the agenda, is Syria, What's Syria? And hearing your keynote, it's very tempting to really just jump into the question of what is the solution and work on the solution. However, I think it's important that we go a little bit step backward and we start with an evaluation a little bit more of what is Syria at the moment and where are we. And Ambassador Hoff talked already about the vacuum of political illegitimacy. And I think this first session, we were going to try to see, so who can represent the Syrian people? Who has the legitimacy? And going after the questions of, is there still one Syria? And in the keynote, some assumption were made about that already. The opposition and Assad was named, and we're going to have a debate about this as well. But I want to start this podium with the third a party in this conflict, or the third option in this conflict, actually the driving force of change, and that is the activists and the people of the ground who have more or less started the revolution. And that's why I want to start with you, Ola. You have been an activist for a long time. You have been there in 2011. I think it's on. 2011. And you also have been to Syria this year. I think it was something in February. And I think nobody in this room will doubt that the activists or the civil society was the sort of the drive of change, the change agent in 2011 when the revolution started. But my question would be, looking at Syria today, besides the tremendous and very great humanitarian work, besides what you say, the 24-hour job in surviving, what can sort of the civil society, what can the activists still do? Are they still an agent of change on the national or on the at least local level?
Thank you, Elias. Well, I think it's important. I mean, I thank you for this opportunity and this platform to discuss the Syrian civil society today, because I think it's pretty much absent from the discussion. When we start talking about Syria nowadays, we talk mainly about ISIS. Media coverage all the time is about ISIS, and sometimes, you know, can focus a little bit on other battles that are happening in different areas in Syria, and sometimes bring the attention to the regime. While we always feel that, you know, the Syrian civil society or the activism on the ground and even outside the country are pretty much missing from the whole picture. What I would like to highlight here is basically what is the civil society doing in Syria right now, and then probably linking it a little bit up with the political process. And I would like to make some comments as well on what has been said before. Basically, the Syrian civil society today is one of the main important actors who are definitely preventing the country from falling apart. Looking at what the civil society are doing in different areas, including the areas that's under ISIS, it's definitely amazing. Syrian civil society before, for the one who doesn't, you know, like, know Syria pretty much, it was absent for like 40 years. So we didn't have a civil society before. It's started basically since 2011 to become with more like a revolutional bodies to end up like to really groups or Syrian people getting together to do different works, either related to the uprising and later on to like different kind of work. Syrian civil society today are basically working on different scope or have different scope. They're doing like documentations of a human rights violation. They are basically doing. They are creating a different kind of initiative that basically helps in de-escalating the violence on local level, which is something we definitely have like to look deeply into it, and probably here I would like to provide some kind of examples of like what actually is being, you know, like done so far. Looking at for example at the ISIS controlled area where you have like everyone almost, you know, out. Who is basically doing like some kind of work to just keep a certain level of secular education, a certain level of community getting somehow together to combat, you know, extremism, are mainly women. So we'd find a lot of women who are basically setting up, you know, houses in secret to provide secular education for kids. You would have other initiatives to find, for example, child recruitment, where we could look at it. Probably we will not be able to provide like a concrete example, because then if it's on media, that would cause people some security situation. But there are others who are looking at what they can actually do, and ISIS would not be angry at them. And then at the same time, they have like a bigger goal, for example, from, you know, attracting the children to, instead of going to join ISIS, is basically to come play together or like, you know, have a football game in some areas, which is like really interesting, because people are finding, you know, like tools, let's say, to deal with the awful situation that they are facing. I would give like other examples for women who basically get together in one of the areas in the countryside of Aleppo and decided that they have to find a kind of prevention mechanism for sexual and gender-based violence, where basically the fighters were coming asking to marry their daughters, and then at the end they didn't have, you know, they can't just easily so say no for an extremist who are coming to marry their daughters. So they started, for example, wearing the ring and telling that the daughters are basically, or the little girls are basically married, and her husband will be back soon, or she has to follow him. So this kind of like, you know, like a local prevention mechanism that basically the community and the civil society grassroots groups are doing. In other areas, for example, in another area in the countryside of Idlib, you find people realize that there is a huge mistrust issue within the Syrians themselves. And looking at this situation, the mistrust is not only with the coalition, it's not only with the political party that exists. It's also between the community and the local councils who started recently to somehow manage the area or the local areas. So they started this initiative to actually start a dialogue on the town level, where they can get the community with the local council to discuss what is actually the issue and how we can deal with it, and how we can actually understand that the local councils might need more expertise, might need more money. They have also their own limitation, which basically when you start to describe all the challenges that you are facing in your daily work, then you get to like a better understanding why we still, you know, need to do more work. There are definitely like plenty of things that I can now think about what the civil society nowadays is doing. And here we're not definitely talking about the humanitarian aids, because basically the civil society have, you know, provided or played a very important role in that area. But trying here to really focus more on what other initiatives that is being taken locally, and which I totally believe that it's giving the whole, you know, like dark picture of Syria today, with like the fragmentation of the opposition and the, you know, the Assad regime and ISIS and many other actors who are involved. There was an important thing that all these local, small, little initiatives are basically how I'm going to say it, is what still give hopes for Syria. It's what we might not see how effective it is nowadays. We might not be able to see the direct impact of those small, local initiatives. But it's definitely creating something. It's building something that can, at the end, you know, like make the floor somehow for a kind of like a national dialogue or a talk or rethinking Syria or what we want to see in the future Syria. Another note that I would like to make here, which is probably also like making some comments of what has been said by Mr. Hof, is the Syrian civil society is not far away from politics. They basically somehow withdrawn from the political scene because they were disappointed by all the political bodies that did exist in the past 4 years, and that basically they had the hope that these political bodies will make change at some point. But there are still see themselves as an important player of, you know, making a solution for this country. I would give the example, for example, for like a recent campaign that was done and we were involved in, is the Planet Syria campaign, where we sat together. And there was like, okay, the whole international community today is looking only at ISIS. And no one actually thinking nowadays about the main cause of the conflict, which is basically a dictatorship and the Assad regime. And we were pretty much aware that if you want to deal with ISIS and extremism, Salafist jihadists, does exist in a wartime. They don't have a place in a peacetime. They do grow in a wartime. And if we want to kick ISIS out, we have definitely to think about an inclusive solution for the whole country. We were talking with activists on the ground, and we did around 277 interviews, face-to-face interviews. And we came up to the point that it's two things, two important things that has to happen together. It's an inclusive peace talk with stopping the barrel bombs, taking further step for the UN resolution, I think 2139, to really think of what, you know, like forcing mechanism measures that we can do to prevent and to stop the barrel bomb, which is considered today the main killer for the Syrians. And another thing, we don't believe that the international peace talk can solve the problem only, but we have to think of all the international or regional actors who are involved in the war in Syria today. We have more than 80 countries who are actively involved in the war in Syria today, and definitely finding a solution. It's not about only negotiating with Syrians and getting all Syrian actors into the negotiated table, but also to like get all those international and regional actors involved, maybe not on the same table, maybe in, you know, like a parallel conference where they can first negotiate that they have to, you know, cut the resources for the Assad regime and cut the other resources as well, and then think of like, you know, a solution.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ola. I think it was very impressive to see how much impact still the civil society actually has in Syria. Jihad Yazici, you asked me already if you could like follow on that. However, I will also give you a question because so we heard about sort of the local initiative. We heard about the civil society down there. Could you elaborate a little bit more about the economic situation, the economic drivers in the areas which are not regime controlled at the moment, and what kind of obstacles they sort of produce in towards a peaceful solution or towards the negotiations?
Thank you, Dias. Good morning to everyone. Thank you, first of all, to Heinrich Böll Foundation for inviting me and organizing this event. I have to say that really since the beginning of the uprising, the foundation has, through the work of the office in Beirut mainly, has shown a clarity and consistency in its position and its work on Syria, which is relatively rare. And I think that it's very important to understand that if we want political compromise, we need to make no compromise on the moral dimension and the moral issue. Making no compromise is a condition to make political compromise. And I think that's very important, and the clarity that it has shown is really impressive. I also want to thank Adopt the Revolution. I have to admit that I had not heard of this organization before coming to Berlin here. And it is really very heartening for us Syrians. As Mr. Hoff said, we feel very much alone, and it's really, you know, when I you know, went through and I thought, well, there are still Germans worried about us, you know, trying to work. And I think the size of the audience shows the seriousness of the organization here. So thank you again. What I would like really to highlight, in my opinion, what matters today for Syrians and for everyone really, is to realize that while we are today in 2015, we are not in March 2011. The Syria we have has dramatically changed. The country is to a very large extent destroyed. Its social fabric is destroyed. Its population is divided physically because of the geographic line. You have populations that are under, surrounded by the reinforcers in plenty of areas. People under ISIS area, people under different areas of rebel control, other under Kurdish control. We have Syrians in Lebanon and Syrians in Jordan already. It has been years and years that these Syrians have been displaced and refugees. The way they see the future has begun to change. when you are like the Syrians in Turks or in Germany, say, for instance, you have papers and you have a future here, which is guaranteed. You can't see your country and whether you will return or not and how you'll be involved in it in the same way that you see it when you are in Lebanon. You have no papers and you have no choice but to go back. And I think it is very important to realize this. So there is a physical destruction. There is already the we know that our future is compromised because of the huge cost to rebuild, and we have our society that is very largely destroyed. Its social fabric is destroyed. What I think is important is for us Syrians to admit to the various fragmentation and dividing lines that this conflict has shown to us. I'm talking here of the sectarian dimension of the conflict, which is very real, in spite of the fact that many people want to avoid talking about it. I'm talking of the Arab-Kurdish divide. I'm talking about the divide between the cities and the rural areas. And I think that these divisions are, I mean, the recognition of these divisions is extremely healthy for us, and that there is no shame in recognizing them. After all, only last year, the Scots had a referendum to have a separate state. There is in every society you have actually divisions. The challenge, I mean, what we do not have in Syria is the institution, the elite, the political space and liberty to discuss, debate, and address them. So because we cannot address them, well, it implodes from everywhere. So I think this is very, very important. Will us, when we are thinking, as you were mentioning, Elias, you were telling me that yesterday you organized a meeting of activists here in Berlin. I think this is very, very important. I mean, we Syrians need to meet and discuss these issues. I think this is a precondition for us to rebuild our country, to acknowledge we cannot, I mean, here again, if we don't acknowledge our differences, it would be very difficult for us to rebuild the country. We cannot deny, for instance, today, that large segments of the Syrian population continue to support the Assad regime. As Mr. Hoff said, the issue here is not a question of opinion. It's a question of right, a question of legitimacy. But the fact is that there are a lot of people who support the Assad regime. So what do we do with these people? There aren't, here again, there is no shame, there aren't more Syrians that support Assad than there were French who supported Pétain, for instance. There were probably many more French that supported Pétain, and when de Gaulle won, they basically shifted. And the story after World War II is that all the French were against, the German occupation, except for a few thousand. But that's not the true story. And in Syria, but of course, the difference is that in the case of World War II, you had a war which people, an army is willing to kick out the Germans, and so de Gaulle could come and say, it's all fine, there are a few bad guys, apart from us, we are all great people. Now we don't have this any army to come and help us, so we have to find a solution to that. How do we do to reconnect together and to rebuild together? And at the same time, of course, being uncompromising on, the issue is not today who began, the issue is not who is committing the war crimes in a systematic and in a systemic manner, it's the regime. It's the regime that is the main responsible for, by very far, for the catastrophe that our people are going through. But the fact that it was the responsible for the catastrophe doesn't mean that every single thing that happened later is only his the responsibility of the regime. So I think this is really where we should start from if we want to rebuild. It is also worth noting, and Mr. Hoff at one point said about the need for Syrians to act as if they were alone. I think that's very, very important. It is quite telling, if you look at the Syrian scene today, is that you have areas controlled by the regime, an area controlled by the PYD, which is the PKK-affiliated Kurdish party, areas controlled by ISIS, and the rebel areas. What is quite telling is that the two outside the regime areas, that the two best managed areas in the country are the areas under control of ISIS and the areas under control of the PYD, which are two organizations that have very clear ideological discourse, and which have no friend whatsoever in terms of regional or international countries. Neither ISIS nor the PYD. The PYD is not supported by any regional country, to my knowledge. contrary to the other Kurds like Barzani, who is supported by the Turks and by other people. While the opposition, which is supported by, which is supposed to be supported by a lot of plenty of other countries, is, as you know, is in a very difficult shape. Of course, the main reason for the disorganization is that the regime is basically bombing only rebel areas. It does not neither bombing the ISIS areas nor the Kurdish areas. So which helps, of course, this organization meet. I think also I have talked of what divides Syrians, but of course it is also very, very important that we realize what unites us, because at the end of the day we need to build on something. If it's only about divisions, there is no future. But there is a future, because there is not. There are a lot of things that unite us. One thing that may sound here not very important, but in the Middle East is important, is patriotism. There is a lot of attachments of Syrians to their country, due to many things. But you see this, you notice this when you go to Lebanon, for instance, where for other reasons you don't have that same type of attachment. It's not a moral judgment on anyone. It's just a reflection of, you know, what I see. The Palestinians, because they never really lived in a separate entity. In Syria, you have that. And there are symbols attached to this. And someone needs to build on this. Another thing Syrians are very, I think there's an agreement over it, is the Syrian state. You notice this everywhere, actually. Syrians, I mean, because the Syrian state for decades, let's be frank, during the 60s and 70s, what helped millions of Syrians get out of poverty, of illiteracy, is systematic investment by the Baath Party in the rural areas, in schools, hospitals, electricity networks, water dams, refineries. Again, it's not a judgment on whether we are pro-Baath or not, but that's a reality. During the 1970s, the annual GDP growth of Syria was 9%. It was one of the highest in the world. You notice, actually, when there was the first uprising in the late 70s and early 80s in Syria, the Horan area, for instance, Daraa, did not move against the regime. These were part of the areas that had benefited for decades. So what I want to say is that you have here and there areas of strong unity, and the state is one of them. So, what Syrians need to do, I mean, I because I follow economic news, I'm really amazed at how some rebel groups bomb a power plant. For instance, recently, a power plant near Zeyzoun, near Hama, and they are celebrating it. And everybody is happy, we bombed the Assad regime power plant. It's a catastrophe. It's not the Assad regime power plant, it's a Syrian power plant. The same thing, the relation with the currency. We are all happy. Not all, luckily, but a lot of people are happy because the Syrian currency is falling. I mean, who is paying the price of the Syrian currency? You think Bashar is paying the price of the Syrian currency? He's getting his, you know, his revenues, his support from Iran. On the contrary, to some extent, he may benefit from it. I think these are issues where we need to be careful at and on which Syrians need to build on, you know? Being very clear in terms of condemning every attempt at destroying state institutions. Because the state is ours, it's not Assad's. And actually, when we are happy, it does mean somewhere that Assad has won. When Assad manages to convince us that even the state is his, it means when he says, because the regime slogan, in Syria you would often say Assad Syria, the Syria of Assad. What we have to do is deprive him of the state. The state is ours, not his. So there are a lot of areas that Syrians can build on. But they need to admit, I think it's very important for us. I think that at the beginning, when the uprising began, all these issues of divisions among society did not matter much. But because we thought we need to, first of all, bring down the regime, so we have the capacity to discuss and negotiate and debate these differences. We didn't have. But now that the war has taken a lot of time, and we are seeing every day a lot of our friends, of our relatives, of people we know who support the regime, we see a lot of Syrian Kurds who actually are more concerned, not a lot actually, but some who are more concerned with autonomous and not with the fight against the regime. So that must tell us something about the state of our society and what we must do to fight Assad. Do you want me still to speak on the economy, or I should stop?
But I do want to get back at one of your points you raised, and you raised it as well, act as if you're alone, because I'm questioning myself if this is possible for the Syrians. I mean, I can understand they could act as they're alone regarding support from the West or military support from the West, but on the other side, they are not alone at all, right? Iran, Russia is supporting the regime on the one side. We have support of Qatar, Saudi Arabia. Even Turkey is deeply involved in the Syrian conflict. So I wonder if you said, yes, we should move towards, as probably the PYD is doing or the Kurds are doing, act as they are alone, how would you manage that with like all this influence getting into the country?
Yes, it's a big challenge, you know, and there are no easy solutions to this. You know, I don't know. I mean, one solution, I don't know if the opposition ever thought of it, but I mean, the PYD has its own, and ISIS, for instance, both of them, they levy taxes. That's how they fund themselves. Why wouldn't the opposition levy taxes in areas under its control? It could even suggest in all southern Turkey, for all Syrian businessmen, one needs to know, for instance, that last year and the previous year, Syrians were the, in terms of number of investors, were the largest foreign investors in Turkey. In 2014, 25% of foreign, 25% of companies established by foreigners in Turkey were established by Syrians, which also indicates that, unfortunately, many of these will probably not return to Syria. So this also lost capital, but that's a different issue. But for instance, the opposition it cannot force because it has no legal right to enforce. It could ask for, a 5% contribution by every Syrian businessman that wants to, that would be put into a fund that would be audited by an independent auditors, for instance, you know. I mean, so levying funds, because money is extremely crucial. Then you have the different influences. What we can try, I mean, that's a big problem of the whole Middle East, actually. The Gulf money is a terrible catastrophe, really, you know, because there's so much money, they basically can buy everyone. I mean, you see Nicolas Sarkozy in France, who worked, I think, with the Qataris or so. So if they can, you know, attract Sarkozy, they can attract all Syrian politicians. It's not difficult, but on the ground, maybe this diversity of donors could be an asset for us, you know, playing on their contradiction and their rivalry. Instead of them being rivals and playing with us, we could use this to play. But first of all, we need to agree on a core set of things that bind us together, that makes it more difficult for all these donors to divide us and play with us. But yeah, it's a challenge.
Ambassador Hoff, let us get one more time sort of to try to figure out what is Syria and what is Syria left. You have talked about already in your keynote speech about the fragmentation of the country. And you have, I found a speech of yourself, you hold in front of the Foreign Senate Committee, where you said that we have addressed the tip of a deadly iceberg, and this iceberg regime policy of mass terror that threatened to sink all attempts to arrest and reverse Syria's slide into Somalia-like failed statehood. You've made these remarks in 2013, so almost 2 years ago, and reading these remarks from 2 years ago, I was wondering from your perspective now and your assessment now on Syria, how far is Syria sliding already in Somalia's statehood if you look at the current map of Syria today? And probably to add on it, I think this is an important question as well, is it still one state? Can we really talk about Syria as one identity still and as one state?
Thank you for the question, Elias. I think when I made those comments, I was speaking specifically about the chemical weapons agreement that was reached. And my point then was that the use of chemicals by the regime, while thoroughly detestable and disgusting, was the tip of a huge iceberg representing a program of mass homicide in Syria, and that was really not being addressed. And one of the many unintended consequences, and I want to stress this phrase, unintended consequences. Syria today is the sum total of unintended consequences of the behavior of actors inside Syria, the behavior of the West and the others. It has not been the intention of President Obama or any of his advisors that Syria would slide in the direction of Somalia-like failed statehood. But one of the unintended consequences of the chemical agreement, which produced some good results, let's be honest about it, relieving this regime of a large, if not all, of its stock of deadly chemicals is a good thing. It's good for the people of Syria. It's good for the people of the region. But the unintended consequence is that the regime felt perfectly free to double down, using every other conceivable form of destruction on civilians. And now the regime is at the point, and this is something that as an American, you know, quite in addition to the suffering of Syrians, I feel this very strongly as an American, the contempt of this Assad regime and its supporters for the President of the United States, the fact that this regime would return quite deliberately, quite openly, to the use of chemicals, now putting chlorine canisters inside of barrel bombs, to me, this is shameful, and I really can't describe adequately how bad this makes me feel as an American, because it was my president, my commander-in-chief, who gave the red line warning on all of this. And I feel bad about this. Syria right now is not Somalia in the sense of a completely failed state. It is sliding, I'm afraid, toward a very informal but perhaps long-term partition between the regime in the West and ISIS or Daesh in the East. There are other elements right now, but these elements are under a lot of pressure from both the regime and Daesh, which generally tend to avoid one another when they can. They concentrate their efforts on the alternatives to each, because what the caliph, Mr. Baghdadi, and Bashar al-Assad have in common is they each want to be one of the two left standing in Syria. This is really what they want. What Bashar al-Assad wants is to confront the United States ultimately with this dilemma. You know, you no longer have a nationalist opposition. You no longer have functioning local committees anywhere. Between us and Daesh, we've taken care of all of this. Now it's just me. It's just me against Daesh. This is what he wants to confront the United States with ultimately, I think.
Let me add a little question to that, or like a little probably provocative question to that. In your sense, hasn't the West and the US contributed to that slide of Syria towards the Somalization in following a strategy since 2011 of giving the Syrian opposition enough materials to have hope that they could sort of win this battle and enough support to sort of to win it, but not enough support to really defend themselves? And I was wondering, nowadays, like I think it was a week ago or 2 weeks ago, the spokesperson of the White House said, in my sense, for the first time after 4 years, that the U.S. will not save Syria. And he made it quite clear. And was wondering, wasn't it a mistake, and didn't it contribute to his lies, to support the illusion for a long time that the West would be the savior of Syria, or would at least be supporting this?
I think, Elias, that the disconnect between administration rhetoric and administration actions or inactions has been disastrous, and frankly, it's had consequences that that transcend Syria. I was in the private sector for many years, and I did a lot of business in my company with Japan. Okay, I know a lot of Japanese people in government, people in business. I have a steady stream of visitors at the Atlantic Council from the Japanese Foreign Ministry, from the Japanese Embassy, all wanting to discuss in considerable detail what is going on in Syria and what is the administration policy. Now, does this herald some brand new Japanese fascination with the Levant? I don't think so. Japan has a mutual defense agreement with the United States. Japan is interested in knowing whether or not that agreement is worth the paper it's printed on. Now, with respect to the opposition, shortly after I left government, and this was in December 2012, the United States announced that it was recognizing the new Syrian National Coalition, the Ettilaf, as the legitimate representative of the Syrian people. You would think that such an announcement would be followed up with a rather substantial program of technical assistance, with the posting of a qualified diplomatic team to Istanbul or wherever to work with this organization to prepare it to govern inside Syria. That never happened. In retrospect, what happened was the creation of a talking point for a Friends of the Syrian People conference taking place in Marrakesh. That was the purpose of this announcement. And I think all the way through in all of this, to include, I guess, most recently, President Obama's interview with Tom Friedman, when he said, you know, the barrel bombing of Syrian children now rises to the level of core American interest. Those are his words. Those are the words of the President of the United States, not the words of Fred Hoff. And the question is, if you are the American commander in chief, and you're going to say words, you're going to say Bashar should step aside, there are red lines that must not be crossed, the barrel bombing of Syrian children is a core American interest, are you not obligated to act on those words? I think the question answers itself.
That is, we're running a little bit out of time, and we want to include you to the debate. But let us have a quick round, at least, regarding a little bit towards solution. And Friedrich Hoff has made an attempt already in his remarks before. I think we're quite clear that there is only a political solution for the Syrian dilemma, and that there will be no military solution. However, the question remains how to get to that political solution, how to get back to political negotiations. And in your keynote, you mentioned that we will not get the regime to the table until the military facts on the ground are changed. And I want to start with Jihad, because the one thing is the military factors are going to change, but I want to know, isn't there a chance that, and this was the hope in 2011, already in 2012, what about, is there a chance that the economic factors will change and will lead Assad to the table? We have talked about already about the slide of the currency. We have talked about the investments which are going outside of the country. So I was wondering, couldn't be, besides the military things, couldn't be the economy a driver to get them to the table?
No. No, it cannot be. You know, a regime that is willing to destroy cities doesn't care much whether its population gets totally impoverished. And what, of course, what the regime needs to have is at least minimum levels of revenues to pay for its Praetorian Guard, you know, for the 30, 40, 50,000 people who need to protect it. And then, you know, help a bit their families. And this, it can always get them. And the Iranians have invested too much that they will always be willing to pay that minimum amounts required. Let us not forget, I mean, what happened in Iraq. Iraqi society, I mean, today it's very easy. Everybody is happy to blame George W. Bush for the Iraqi catastrophe, which is, of course, true. But we forget that for 12 years, there were regime sanctions that destroyed the fabric of Iraqi society, that pushed Iraqi women to prostitution, Iraqi children to begging, men to Daesh at the end of the day, more or less, you know. So, but 12 years of sanctions against Saddam didn't do anything. I think the average pension or salary at before he fell was of the average Iraki civil servant was, I don't know, $1 or maybe 10, or I can't remember. And he remained in power. So no, it cannot. I think the Syrian economy is going extremely bad. People are getting poorer and poorer. If you want, Elias, we have a record of when the regime makes concession historically, and it is very clear. It is when you apply enormous military pressure on the regime. We've seen that in 1998 when the Turks wanted Öcalan out of Syria. The Turks pressed the regime 10 days, 15 days. They didn't shoot a single bullet. And Hafez Assad gave completely up his Öcalan card, which was his only card against the Turks. Again, seven years later, 2005, some strong military pressure, some threats from Bush then, and Bashar got out of Lebanon, and Bush didn't shoot a single bullet at him, but he got out. And Lebanon was the major card in the hands, the major prize of the Assad regime. And again, we saw that in 2013, when Barack Obama decided to use the leverage he has and put pressure. And look how, without shooting a single bullet, he gave up on his only weapons, only deterrent, if you want, significant deterrent again. So nobody is going can convince us that if, what, it's 10:40, if it's at 12, Barack Obama sends two Tomahawk missiles on Hama airport and on no other airport, which is used to barrel bomb Aleppo. This afternoon, barrel bombing stops, meaning tomorrow morning, dozens of thousands of people come back from the refugee camps. The flow to ISIS reduces. The civil society organization can get back to Aleppo, meaning a rebalancing between the civilian and arming segment, a rebalancing between the secular and the Islamist. It can be done pretty quickly, but economic factors, they don't play ground. And you were saying there is no other solution than the political one. I agree with you, but I also, what we should say, there is no political solution before without a military action or change in balance of power. I think the two work together, but the economy, unfortunately, I don't think. We thought, at the beginning that sanctions, we've seen that they have had no impact.
Yeah. Ola, let me continue with you. Adding up on jihad, so if the thesis is the military facts have to change on the one side, and as you said in your last remark, there will be no contribution for the West for military change. What can, of your perspective, in that time until the West moves or until we're going further down the road, how can the civil society and the activists contribute to moving towards, or can they contribute moving towards the negotiations, and what would be needed to get there? Because, I mean, it's a debate which is on there for a long while, right? I mean, I remember debates in 2012 where we said, okay, let's talk about the military intervention, and then there was no military intervention. We talked about it and said, okay, the solution is the military intervention, but nobody was willing to do that. So given the fact that there will be probably no bigger military support, what do we do?
Well, as I was saying couple of minutes ago, that basically the Syrian civil society, who are the Syrian civil society today? They're basically the people who went to the streets. 70% of the Syrian civil society are young generation who participated and contributed to the uprising since the beginning. So they do have the values of change, and they still see themselves as an important player in the whole in the whole scene. Probably because of the fragmentation, they were disappointed. They pulled out from the political scene. But nowadays, I can see that there is a little bit of change regarding this issue. People are like more now keen to, for example, play. Be there in the negotiation table. Some people from the Syrian civil society are basically saying that we don't want to be a party, like, or an actor in the negotiation table. We want to be a monitoring party, just like, you know, giving recommendation and being there to observe the whole process. And some others say that no, we need to be included, even though we don't have like a political agenda, but we need to be included in the negotiation table. So definitely Syrian civil society can play an important role on the track one level, on the high level. However, till this will happen, and we have no idea if this will happen soon. I mean, the Geneva consultation is taking place right now. People are hoping that there will be Geneva 3, which is might be not the case, seriously, because, you know... There should be other elements where we're saying that, you know, like an action really to like force Assad to get into the negotiation table and others. However, if this didn't happen, I think the Syrian civil society will continue at least with the work that they are doing to de-escalate the violence in their areas and continue to contribute in a way or another to the humanitarian aids, to the documentations of human rights, transitional justice and all others.
Ambassador Hoff, last question before we open for the audience. Probably a little more or less the same question for you. We have 20 more months left of the Obama administration. I would assume it's highly unlikely that he will go for such a big military conflict in the last 20 months of his presidency. It probably will lead it to the new president coming up. So my question, if your thesis is change will only happen if there will be a military action, what happens if this doesn't come?
You know, if you take the current situation in Syria, and you just do a flatline projection of business as usual for the next 20 months, and add a few months to that for an incoming administration to get its policy act together. You can look at current numbers. I mean, you can easily think in terms of a 500,000 people dead, refugee and displaced numbers up 50%, a continued implosion of the economy inside regime-controlled areas. You know, I referred earlier to some of my closest Syrian friends who are sticking with the regime. Even these people are under no illusion that the Assad regime has any ability or even interest in managing an economy on something other than a kleptocratic nature. You've had, you know, the Syrian economy, such as it is, has devolved into a Shabiha economy. I personally, having been a member of this administration, having been a political appointee in this administration, I refuse to give up hope. I just refuse to give up hope. I am not an enemy of President Barack Obama. I supported his election twice, even after leaving the administration. I am a military veteran of Vietnam and the Lebanese Civil War. I am not a great enthusiast for military intervention. I know firsthand what the costs of these things are. And yet, I think my president is wrong in his belief that to do anything at all to protect Syrian civilians, to put these barrel bombs out of business, to do anything at all, puts you on a slippery slope to invasion and occupation. This is the president's belief. I think he's wrong, and I simply will not give up hope that he can be persuaded otherwise.
Now the time is for questions, and it's just some probably rules for that. And please raise your hand and wait for the microphone. I will point at you because we have translation back there. It would be good if you say the name and the institution, if you have one. And probably it would be very nice, since I'm very sure we have a big debate, if you keep it to questions, not so much another comments, but to keep it to questions and keep the questions short, and probably name out who should be addressed. And you can ask the questions in your favorite language, unless it's German, English, or Arabic. We should narrow it down to these three.
Hey, is this on? Okay. Hello. First, I might introduce myself. I'm Christiane Müller. I'm a German journalist for public television and a camerawoman. And I did a lot on the Syrian uprising for ARD television. I wanted to ask you, Mr. Frederick Hof, a question on the Syrian National Stabilization Force you were demanding in your addressing speech. How many recruits do you already have gathered, and where do you want to gather those recruits from? We know in my research, to tell the audience, I realized that we have some problems with the rebels in the south. The American military operation room in Jordan is supporting those rebel forces, for instance, Shabab as-Sunna. And we could see in the storming of the ancient town of Busra in March 2015 that there is indeed a problem with sectarianism, that those forces were trying to kill the minority of the Shia in Busra. And on the other side, maybe you know that Busra is a World Heritage town. And what we also face now is that those rebel forces are looting those historical sites. And how do you monitor those rebels? Because you were telling that there is this third force needed in order to do something against the strong military capability of the
probably,
Assad.
Probably we can leave it here, yeah. Just to keep it a little bit shorter.
So how do you monitor those rebels, and where do you recruit them? Okay, thank you very much.
Let us take two more questions so we get on going. I think there was one in the back as well who was very fast, and one front here. Start with the front here.
Ja, ich möchte die vorangegangene Frage unterstützen, und zwar vor dem Hintergrund, Herr Hoff, weil Sie ja sehr viel über Legitimität am Anfang gesprochen haben. Und für mich ist also auch ganz stark die Frage, inwieweit ist denn diese Stabilisierungstruppe in irgendeiner Art und Weise legitimiert? Also was ist die Legitimation dieser Truppe? Ich habe eine zweite Frage. Und zwar haben Sie ja vom Westen gesprochen. Für mich ist die große Frage, wer ist denn überhaupt der Westen? Es ist relativ klar, die USA gehören dazu, die Bundesrepublik gehören dazu, aber gehört auch die Türkei noch dazu? Gehört Saudi-Arabien dazu und gehört vor allem Katar dazu? Wir wissen ja alle...
Okay, vielleicht bleiben wir es bei diesen zwei Fragen, um sozusagen noch andere mit aufzunehmen.
Ja, ich hätte gerne noch eine dritte Frage.
Ist sie kurz?
Die ist kurz, und zwar... eine ganz kurze Vorbemerkung.
Bitte nur die Frage.
Sonst ist sie nicht verständlich. Die USA arbeiten ja zumindest auf einer informellen Ebene auch mit der PYD zusammen. Die Bombenangriffe auf IS-Stellungen in Kobane, Jizira und so weiter werden ja mit den USA koordiniert. Jetzt die Frage, weshalb wo Kobane jetzt befreit ist, weshalb lässt man die Zivilisten dort allein? Ist es nicht auch eine Aufgabe der USA oder des Westens, dafür zu sorgen, dass die Türkei die Grenze aufmacht, dass die Leute dort wieder normal leben können, dass vielleicht die 200.000 Leute, die dort fliehen mussten, auch wieder zurückgehen können und nicht hierher fliehen müssen?
Okay, and there's a third question up here, and then I will get you. Yes.
أنا أمل نصر من سوريا. ناشطة سياسية ومدنية من قبل الثورة معتقلة سياسية بعام 2014 ومحكومة بالإرهاب من قبل النظام منذ 6 أشهر أنا لاجئة سياسية في سويسرا بسبب حكم الإرهاب أنا مهتمة بما قاله السيد فريدريك نريد أن نقول لكل المجتمع الدولي أننا نريد إرادة سورية سورية في الحل السوري السياسي رأينا أنه لا مجال لأي انتصار عسكري لأي طرف من الأطراف لا يمكن أن يتحقق الحل السوري السياسي إلا بإرادة سورية عندما تجفف منابع التمويل إلى الأطراف المتنازعة عنفيا ولا يمكن للإرادة السورية أن تظهر إلا عندما يكون جنيف 3 متحقق وفي لقائنا الأخير بالسيد ديمستورا المبعوث الخاص الأممي كان هناك اهتماما جادا منه أن هناك جنيف 3 سيكون على الطاولة قريبا لكن ما نراه غير ذلك من خلال سلوكيات من يدعون أنهم أصدقاء الشعب السوري من خلال مواقف الدول الداعمة لكل الأطراف المتنازعة عنفيا لا يمكن لجنيف 3 أن يتحقق إلا ما عند تكون هذه الأطراف على طاولة المفاوضات اللاعبين الدوليين والإقليميين والعربيين والمحليين جميعا وذلك بالبدء بوقف العنف أولا بفك الحصار بالإفراج عن المعتقلين بخلق المناخ المناسب لهذا العمل هذا العمل لا يمكن أن يتم إلا إذا كان هناك إرادة دولية حقيقية بإيقاف الحل العسكري لا نريد تدخلا عسكريا لا نريد أن نكون عراقا ثانيا نريد أن نكون بحل سوري سوري يخرج من السوريين بوقف أي دعم عنفي لسوريا الآن لا نريد هذا الأمر لا نريد هذا أو لا نرى أن هذا الأمر جادا من قبل كل الأطراف إن كانت أمريكا أو روسيا إيران أو السعودية إن كانت الاتحاد الأوروبي الكل نراه يدعم العنف ولا يدعم الحل السياسي شكرا
Freddy Koff.
Okay, I think all the questions were directed to me, so I'll be brief because I would like my partners to have some equal opportunity here. First of all, the question about the Syrian National Stabilization Force, I would urge you to please read the report. I left some copies out front. It is online. These questions are addressed by the report. You can decide whether or not they're addressed adequately. How many recruits are we looking for initially? It would be a force, and bear in mind, this is our recommendation. This is not the policy of the United States. The United States has a train and equip program that attempts over 3 years to recruit approximately 16,000 people to provide a ground component for the air campaign against Daesh in Syria. I mean, can you imagine how insignificant this is? Can you imagine the implications for the people of Syria of allowing Daesh 3 more years to sink roots inside Syria while its operatives are being chased from 30,000 feet by airplanes, by high-performance aircraft? Our proposal looks to recruit a force initially the size of 50,000. What is essential to this, though, and we go at length at this in the report, is having Syrian guidance and input in all of this. This goes to the question of legitimacy. There are Syrians who know where and how to recruit the appropriate people to this force. People who will be open to being trained not only in the basic combat skills of fire and maneuver, but in civil military skills having to do with the protection of people, the protection of arts, monuments, archives, the whole thing. It is essential. The United States and its external partners do not have the requisite skills or knowledge to recruit the proper people to this effort. There has to be a major Syrian input and direction to this. And in terms of the current train and equip program, I am seeing no evidence that there is any Syrian input into this process yet. It is Syrian input that would give a sense of legitimacy to this undertaking. Otherwise, it looks very much like a colonial effort. Who is the West? In my remarks, the West, basically, I'm talking about the United States, Western Europe, Japan, North America. Turkey kind of bridges between the West and being a regional power. Civilians in the post-Kobani situation. This is very much the subject of discussions ongoing now between General John Allen, retired Marine Corps general who was President Obama's special envoy to the coalition, and the Turkish government. To the best of my knowledge, a satisfactory response to this problem has not yet been arrived at, but it's something that the General Allen, I know, an extraordinarily capable man, is very interested in it. Military solution, not an option. Geneva negotiations, again, as somebody who has served in multiple combat situations, I am not an enthusiast for a military solution. But as I look at the situation in Syria, as I look at the prospects for a diplomatic solution, what I see is a very one-sided situation on the ground that is encouraging one key party in all of this to abstain from any kind of serious political negotiation. Geneva II, quite aside from the decent, respectable performance of the opposition, quite aside from that, it was a disaster. It was a disaster. The Assad regime dispatched its UN representative to come to Geneva and to lecture his opposite numbers, telling them that they were all engaged in treason, asking if they understood the penalty for treason in the Syrian Arab Republic. I come to the reluctant conclusion that unless the regime's calculation, and perhaps more importantly, Iran's calculation in all of this is altered, there is not much of a prospect for a political process here. And that calculation, I am sorry to say, is based almost entirely, if not totally, on military conditions on the ground.
I have a good news as well as a bad news. The bad news, let me start with the bad news. The bad news is the coffee break will be postponed of 15 minutes. The good news is we have 50 more minutes for the discussion here. So we can make another one, probably two rounds of questions. It's really hard to see who was first, so let me start with the man in this row down here. I think it's... We wait until the microphone. It's a little bit further to the front, etwas mehr hier. Vielleicht könnt ihr den Arm nochmal gerade da winken. Genau.
Burkhard Weitz vom Evangelischen Magazin Chrismon. I have a question to all of you. Two questions. One to Mr. Hoff. May you give me a short update on the outcome of the agreement which was made on the destruction of the chemical weapons? I haven't heard of it ever since. So is it working? Are they being destroyed? Is there anyone who controls it? And do you have numbers? And the question to Mrs. Ramadan and Mr. Yazigi. How do we know that the option of democracy is as important to the Syrian civil society as is the option of having a state, a stable regime, able to supply everybody with basic needs?
Then we have one in the back first, Mayada. It's probably a wave.
ميادة خليل من النشطاء اللي انقمعت مظاهراتهم بال2004 بجامعة حلب ومن النشطاء اللي طلعوا بالمظاهرات من أول يوم كمان حاليا أنا لاجئة ببرلين من سنة ونص تقريبا عم يحكوا إنه ما في مشاركة سورية نحن ثلاثة هون قاعدين علا رمضان أمل نصر عم نشتغل بمبادرة سورية من ما قبل جنيف واحد أعتقد يعني المبررات للعطل الدولي غير موفقة. نحن بنشتغل بمبادرة سورية مشاركة مع اليو إن. نحن بدنا حل سوري والسوريين محتاجين لهذا الحل ومحتاجين لوقف العنف بسوريا. يكفي قول السوريين غير موجودين. نحن غير موجودين بإرادة دولية. شكراً.
Herzberg, I'm working as counselor by Arbeiterwohlfahrt with asylum seekers, actually helping them for the asylum procedure here in Germany, but also for the family reunification. And I have a short question to Mrs. Ramadan. You were there in Syria in February. I'm wondering how is it working actually with the food supply, the medical supply, and actually for me, the whole papers, documents for families, because actually to come here in the case for family reunification, you need a lot of papers. Is it actually working in Syria?
Okay, and last question for this round, and then we will see if we can manage another round.
Thank you. I'm Ola Saleh from Syria. And my question is also directed towards Mr. Hoff. I think it's a national stabilization force. It's nothing we do when the violent conflict is still going on. It is something for the DDR phase. That's for a start. Because who decides what's national and what's not? Again, back to the legitimacy and complicating the military scene on the ground. A good example of how people can contribute to elevating the violence levels in Syria is the Geneva Call initiative, where they work with the military forces and train them on the IHL, International Humanitarian Law, and make them sign agreements, so to speak, to abide by it, instead of recruiting people and forming an additional force. That's for a start. And I must say I'm very, very cynical towards the passive-aggressive United States stand in diplomacy towards all conflicts, not only Syria, and astonished by how little the American administration learns from its involvement in different conflicts around the world. And I would like to hear from you, Mr. Hoff, which I was hoping for, actually, when you said a third force. I really, my eyes sparkled, But then when you said military, I was just like down again. Can you come up with a third force that is rather diplomatic and political? And I would like to second Ola when she said, we need to include the regional and international actors who are part of this conflict in any sort of political solution. Thank you.
Okay, why don't we start with Ola this time, and then we're going to go to Frederick Hoff.
Yeah, I want to actually start answering the question, and maybe, Jihad, if you want to add something else on my answer, then you're welcome. For the question that about how do we know that the Syrian civil society wants democracy, not the stable state? I'm just gonna look back at the 4 years now. Over 200 people were killed mainly by the Assad regime. 4,000 refugees in the countryside in the neighboring country. 8 million IDPs inside the country. It's a whole disaster. Trust me, dear. People now, when they look at the situation, they have first to deal with the whole, with the past. With all, it's not past, it's still ongoing. People will not accept, despite if they want democracy or not, despite if they are looking for an Islamic state or what, or not. But for them, it's basically about, you know, something started 4 years ago, and it's not at all easy to just say today, okay, let's have the Assad back. Let's have a stable state, and we forget about what happened over the past 4 years. Okay, the other question about the lady who asked about the food supply and the paper. I was actually in Hasaka region, which is under the PYD control. It's pretty much different from the other areas, looking at Aleppo or like Idlib, Deir ez-Zor or other areas, or the regime area control. Mainly the regime area control, as everybody knows, it's mainly the UN agencies and the Red Cross is still carrying on the humanitarian aid, and basically this is, you know, like they can't provide the work without the agreement of the regime. But on the other part of the country, which is under the, I wouldn't say the other opposition's control, I think it's pretty much the civil society who are doing the food supply. Most of like local activists who were created some kind of a group, and they get supported from international communities. Some international communities does exist in Syria, but this is mainly in Hasaka, like Save the Children and CARE and others. They have no offices in Hasaka under the PYD protection. It really depends from an area to another area. However, when it comes to the paper, well, it's pretty much complicated. Also depends from the area. In the regime area, you can easily get any paper that you want. Not easily, depends if you are wanted by the regime or not. There are some other instructions. But in the areas which is non-governmental area control, ISIS or other opposition's control or other armed group, it's very complicated to do any kind of paperwork that would cause like a really, you have to take a big risk. For example, if you want to cross from Aleppo, the liberated, what is called the liberated part, to the regime part to get paper. And some people do risk their life, but it's pretty much complicated.
Okay. On the chemical weapons agreement, I think the United Nations, and for that matter, the United States, are fundamentally satisfied that the regime's collection, its arsenal of chemical weapons, has in fact been removed and neutralized. Recently, there was a report of traces, I believe, of sarin or one of the forbidden materials found at a military base. This is under investigation now. Chlorine, per se, is not a forbidden substance, although its application in military use is contrary to international law. I think the administration's position on this now is that the United Nations should investigate the use of chlorine in a military mode. This investigation will take time. The fact that the chlorine has been delivered in barrel bombs dropped from helicopters is rather suggestive, I think, of the source. Again, on the question of the Syrian National Stabilization Force, I would urge you, you know, to the extent you're really interested in looking into the pros and cons of this, read the report. This is not simply an advocacy piece. We tried to weigh very carefully all of the pros and cons. I'm not the least bit opposed to trying to train existing local forces in international humanitarian law. I don't oppose that at all. I think the obstacles, given the fact that some of the leaders of these local forces are not particularly interested in the subject, given the fact that these local forces, even forces that would be interested in the subject, are under continuing pressure from at least two directions, and possibly three, kind of suggests that you do need an independent effort where a respectable training program can be built and implemented. Has the United States learned not enough from prior military experiences? Yeah, I'd be inclined, just for the sake of being cooperative here, to plead guilty to that. Sometimes we overlearn, sometimes we underlearn. I think when President Bush decided in late 2002, early 2003, that the United States was going to invade and occupy Iraq, I think what he probably had in mind, based on his reading of American history and the efficacy of American military power, was a very easy, very decisive campaign. And I know, in fact, from people who were involved in that decision-making process, I was mercifully in the private sector at the time, that this was a real guiding principle of the invasion of Iraq, that this was going to be easy. As one of my colleagues told me from government, this is going to be Grenada. You all remember the invasion of Grenada. The phrase was, this was going to be Grenada with goats. And it didn't turn out that way. Now President Obama's view of this is that the efficacy of American military power is basically summed up historically by what happened in Iraq. I think that's just as incorrect. The United States is capable of doing things effectively and intelligently. Having said that, I want to emphasize that I am not a cheerleader for military intervention. I come to the very reluctant conclusion that there are no available means in our hands right now to protect Syrian civilians from the mass homicide campaign that is taking place that are not military in nature at some level. If we can negotiate with Iran to ground the regime's helicopters, if we can somehow get to General Soleimani and convince him that war crimes and crimes against humanity are not the way, not the appropriate way for Iran to achieve its regional objectives, I am totally in favor of that. I come to the reluctant conclusion that a fruitful, creative, and effective diplomatic process in this situation, without a military dimension, without that dimension, I'm sorry to say, it does not exist.
I have again good and a bad news. The bad news is I've seen all the hands up there, but the time is up, so we won't have any further question. The good news is the coffee break is coming up, and we can discuss it here. But before we go to the coffee break, I really want to thank you, the panelists up here, who made a long journey from Washington, from Istanbul, and from Beirut. And it just have two more announcements to make. First of all, in you have all evaluation form inside the map. I would ask, please fill out this information form. And the second one is that Adopt a Revolution, and this is a little bit advertising, Adopt a Revolution have a newsletter which is coming up every 2 weeks or monthly about Syria, where we trying to focus on different issues of Syria. If you're interested, you can fill out your email address at the Adopt a Revolution form. And see you after the coffee break at, I think it's 11:40 now. Thank you very much.